thank you, Dean Wood, very much for mentioning Brusco and Giovanni, whom I love dearly. Brusco is a giant talking wolf from the mountains of central Italy in the middle of the 19th century. And Giovanni is a little boy who's his best friend. If that doesn't move you to buy the book, then there's nothing else I can say. and this setup is much more than I expected. This chair is so comfortable. I've had students fall asleep on me in class, but so far I've never fallen asleep on me. So this is your first. This is just wonderful. Well, today I'm not going to lecture. I thought it best to read some C.S. Lewis. So I'm going to be doing a lot of quoting from C.S. Lewis today. And the title of this session is Joy, a Rumination, which doesn't mean it's random, but it does mean it's personal. So I hope you'll be patient with my own preferences. Now, why? Why did I decide to do this? Well, first of all, we know what Lewis said about joy. Joy is the serious business of heaven. Now, I don't know of any more important thing that can be said about something than that it is the serious business of heaven. I mean, where do you go from there? You know, that's about as important as it can get. And it's often dismissed as a mere phrase. Lewis was this great phrase maker, you know, everything not eternal is eternally out of date. And it sounds nice to say it, and then you have to think about it a while and put it back in context, because there's much more depth than meets the ear. Joy is the serious business of heaven. And I will go further than that. I will say, in my opinion, of course, that it is the central attraction of C.S. Lewis. It is the axle of a wheel from which all the other spokes emerge. So that's one reason. The second reason I've decided to do this is to answer what I regard as a silly question. At another event, not too long ago, a young man rose to ask the question. And he said, Professor, what does C.S. Lewis have to say to young people of my generation? And I found that such an insipid question. I didn't know what to say. Do you suppose your generation has DNA that different from other generations? Do you suppose that your youthfulness is such a distinctive youthfulness that previous youths were, you know, silly to like Lewis, and somehow he has to appeal to you? I just didn't know what to say. He's now digitized. You can get him online. What do you say? So you say, no, joy is the serious business of heaven. If that's not good enough for you, if you're 7 or 17 or 27, then maybe Lewis is not for you. The other reason for doing this is something I alluded to last night. Lewis, we know, is now a cultural landmark. This was not always the case. Lewis is no longer a contemporary author. When I began to read Lewis 55 years ago, he was still a contemporary, well, not quite 55, because I didn't know him when he was still alive, but he was still a contemporary author. Now he's not a contemporary author anymore. Right? He's of a different age, really. And much of what didn't have to be annotated 50 years ago now has to be annotated. When you read C.S. Lewis, for references and historical context and so on. And yet, millions of books have been sold, dozens of languages now convey Lewis's thought in translation. He's quoted in places now, like the TLS, the New York Times, on television, as a cultural figure worthy of consideration, which wasn't the case 50 years ago. We used to actually keep track of when Lewis broke through in the public press because it was so infrequent. You can't do that anymore. So he's established. And of course, it's the case that these days, many more people know of Lewis and about him than actually read him. And you know, that's always a dividing line in a public figure. So he's obviously an important writer. He's obviously influential. He matters. Right? He doesn't matter to English departments, by the way, which is a real gripe of mine. He's not on the syllabus, and his critical works even have fallen into neglect. How then does he mostly matter? And my answer to that is a personal answer. I take it that I'm not different from most other people who love C.S. Lewis and who read him assiduously. And that is, he matters to me on the inside. Lewis matters because what he does to individual people when they read him, now they'll get together in societies and they'll talk about him. You know, to an outsider, they'll sound rather foolish. I know we've been called cultists. You know, people who join the Byron Society aren't called cultists, but somehow if you're a member of the T.S. Lewis Society, you're a cultist. But the difference is that Lewis changes you on the inside. So what matters about Lewis is that change. It's a very individual change. So that's why I've decided to do this tonight. Who is this person who has changed? I'm not about to launch into a long autobiography, but a couple of things. As a little boy, until I was about 5, I really did believe that all animals could speak, but chose not to. I would make my Slavic grandmother and my Italian father retell me the same stories all the time. My father would tell me Jack and the Beanstalk all the time. And Jack, the giant, would fall and make a big hole in the ground. And I once said to him, "Daddy, what happened to Jack and his mother after that?" And he thought a while and he said, "Well, they did okay. They made a swimming pool out of a hole that the giant made and opened a motel." They became very successful. And I was about 7 at the time, and for a while, maybe a year, I thought I might actually find that motel as we drove here and there. So that's, in one way, the kind of person I was. Now, fast forward, I'm now writing my dissertation on my master's thesis on parallel, but I had not read Narnia. I put it off for some reason. But I'm writing and I'm working very hard. And God blessed me then with the worst cold I had had to that date in my life. Just, I mean, it was one of those things that lay you up and you can do nothing but move your eyeballs. And so I couldn't work anymore. I mean, any reasonable person could see you can't actually sit at a machine and type it. So I read the Chronicles of Narnia. In 5 days, I read the 7 books. And just to make sure the cold wouldn't go away, I lay near a slightly open window. It was wintertime. I didn't want this cold to go away too quickly. And of course, I was swept away. I was swept away to that reality right around the corner. I said to myself, so this finally, see, is how Scripture is intended to work. Now, I knew the New Testament was largely history, and I knew Narnia was not largely history, but still, the stirring in my heart is what Scripture should do. Point to another world and let you know that it's home and that you have to get there somehow. So it was quite a big deal to me, and my new hero became Lucy. There's nobody like Lucy. Now, there's another thing you have to know about me, and I'm speaking now to my new and already very dear friend, Nick Knickerbocker. We were talking last night after the lecture. I still teach one course a semester, and if I didn't teach this course, I would sit at my desk and talk out loud to myself. It just so happens that there are other people in the room whom I'm speaking to, but they're almost incidental because I just need that thrill, that intellectual excitement. You know, the cat won't pay attention anymore. My My wife has given up saying, are you talking to me? I really do talk to myself out loud. And she no longer says, what did you say? Because she knows I must not be talking to her. In my book, Branches to Heaven, I make a big deal, because Lewis made a big deal, out of a very wonderful book, a strange book called The Crock of Gold by James Stevens. And it's about a philosopher, and I want to quote a little bit of this, because it applies to me, as you've already experienced, but it also applies to my friend Nick. There's no such thing as too much C.S. Lewis, in my opinion. There's no such thing as too much talk about C.S. Lewis, in my opinion. And there's no such thing as conversation, which is the other book is about conversation that I just published. I will not stop talking. To them, there are only two kinds of sounds. These are the two philosophers who talk. There were only two kinds of sound anywhere. These were conversation and noise. They liked the first very much indeed, but they spoke of the second with stern disapproval. Do you know that a leprechaun came here today? Said his wife. Are you going to listen to what I am telling you about the leprechaun? Said the thin woman. I am not, said the philosopher. Will you ever be done talking? Shouted the woman passionately. I will not, said the philosopher. Well, that's my wife and me. That was C.S. Lewis, who was a great conversationalist, as we know. And so I read the Chronicles of Narnia and was, as I said, thrilled in a way I'd never been thrilled before. And with parts of the Bible at the time. And I realized what it was that had thrilled me. I found by accident, if you believe in accidents, I happen not to believe in accidents. Psalm 45, you have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore God, your God, has anointed you with, can anyone finish the phrase? The oil of life. That's it. No. That's the Holy Spirit, the oil of gladness. From Isaiah, to grant to those who mourn in Zion to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness. And finish it with the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. All of this struck me as being what Narnia was about. And when I talked earlier about it having a personal impact, that's the impact it had on me. I hadn't read the phrase oil of gladness before, but it all hung together very well. In 2 Corinthians, finally, therefore we are not discouraged, rather... Am I sermonizing? Well, do you want to quote 2 Corinthians 4? We are not discouraged, rather, although our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal... Does anybody know what comes next now? An eternal...
Weight of glory.
Yes, Weight of Glory, and many of you, of course, will recognize that as the title of one of Lewis's sermons, which I'll get to later on. Weight of Glory. Beyond all comparison, as we look not to what is seen, but what is unseen, for what is seen is transitory, but what is unseen is eternal. Well, some of you may think that 20 years old is rather old to be learning this stuff. But that's how old I was when it started to sink in. And it all began with Narnia. It all began with Narnia. One of the things that Narnia inspired and that Lewis inspired, and by the way, before I go on, let me voice an opinion. If you wanted to know what to read of C.S. Lewis, that expressed most deeply the central part of Lewis. It is, in my judgment, that's certain, the weight of glory. I do regard it as a miniature summa by C.S. Lewis. Not mere Christianity, but the weight of glory. And I'll be quoting from it later on. But it may be the most important thing C.S. Lewis ever wrote. Now, when I say the most important thing, I don't mean the best known, or the most widely sold, or the most popular. They're not going to make a movie out of The Weight of Glory, you know, that kind of thing. But in terms of what I'm regarding as important, its impact on an individuated human soul, expressing what mattered most to C.S. Lewis, that's it, The Weight of Glory. Narnia also inspired something which Lewis is better at than anyone else I know. And it's best expressed by the Greek word eidos, A-I-D-O-S. Let me quote the great Tom Howard. Some of you have read Tom Howard, I know. He's a wonderful critic of C.S. Lewis and one of the most elegant writers you can ever read. He says the following: "For a start, Lewis hailed us with sheer goodness, a quality which, if it's not jeered at in our day, is deeply suspected of being either humbug or trumpery. In this general category of goodness, we find ourselves in Narnia regaled with such forgotten or derided qualities as nobility, valor, civility, reticence, courage, purity, merriment, and something the Greeks called eidos, for which we have no English word. It denotes the capacity in one to be awed by what is authentically awesome, as opposed, say, to loud noises and strobe lighting and ear-splitting profanity and nudity on stage. Real hereditary majesty, for example, or excellence in the craftsmanship that has gone into a sword, or a chair, or a sunset, or great alpine peaks glittering in the sun, or the voice of a splendid operatic soprano, or, interestingly enough, homespun simplicity, or charity in a good household, not to mention holiness in a man or a woman. Eidos recognizes all of these qualities and revels in them." Well, this happens a lot in Lewis. It happens mostly, I think, in the Chronicles of Narnia. And that's what Tom was talking about. A very good example of this I saw some years ago in a television commercial of all places. I wonder if you had this experience. The really great television commercials advertise products which you soon forget. You remember the commercial, but I cannot for the life of me recall what this commercial was advertising. It's a sunny climate, Southern California apparently, and it's Christmas time. It came out during Christmas. And a car is driving down the street, and apparently it's kind of a gangbang of cars hopping up and down, and the boys inside have bandanas on their heads, and they're all kind of, you know, moving and shaking to the car. And as they go by, one boy in the back seat looks out the window and does a double take, and his jaw drops, his mouth opens, his eyes pop wide, and as he's going by, the camera shows you what he sees. And it's a Christmas scene. The house has lights, there's creche in the yard, you know, and there's Jesus and Mary over the baby. And it's just beautiful, as only a Hollywood commercial can be. It's just beautiful. He's no longer in his car. He's no longer in this gang. He's no longer on his way to do whatever he was going to do. He's out of himself into something else. And then when he moves by very quickly, he kind of snaps out of it and remembers what he should pretend to be. But he'll never forget what he can be because of that one moment. Well, that's what eidos can do, because he was awed. That's how simple that is. Well, I don't want to make this too much of a potpourri, but I would like to quote the great G.K. Chesterton. Before I get to Narnia, there are some quotations from Narnia. What G.K. Chesterton said about fairy tales. Because, you know, Chesterton is full of wisdom. And this is a sample. "Civilization changes. But fairy tales, they never change. You know, you were the same as I as a little boy. When my grandmother told me Hansel and Gretel, if she changed something, I would remind her that she was wrong. It didn't happen that way. It happened this way. As though she were merely the transmitter of the story. Some of the details of the fairy tale may seem odd to us, but its spirit is the spirit of folklore. And folklore is, in the strict translation, the German for common sense. Fairy tales are the oldest and gravest and most universal kind of human literature. A seven-headed dragon is perhaps a very terrifying monster, but a child who has never heard about him is a much more terrifying monster than he is. The maddest griffin or chimera is not so wild a supposition as a child without fairy tales. The human race that we see walking about anywhere is a race mentally fed on fairy tales, as certainly it is as it is a race physically fed on milk. And I certainly believe that that's the case, and it certainly is the case with Narnia. Now, how did Lewis, in general, accomplish his magic? And, of course, one answer is imagination. Lewis was a wonderful imaginative writer, but we know he was also a great Christian apologist. And he could reason and argue with the very best of them. Lewis supposedly lost one debate at the Socratic Club that he founded and was president of. But the woman, Elizabeth Anscombe, who supposedly beat him, just didn't understand why people thought he lost. She became a very world-renowned Catholic philosopher and an interpreter of Wittgenstein, by the way, Elizabeth Anscombe. She said, all I did was elucidate one mistake that I thought he made. He didn't really lose a debate. She didn't see it that way. But he was formidable. He was formidable. Now, I think one of his secrets is a progression. I call them the four P's, the progression of the four P's. He starts with something which is possible. If you remember the book Miracles, what he does in the first three chapters of Miracles, or four, is clear away the unexamined assumptions that make it impossible to believe in miracles. For example, he points out that if you don't believe in God, well then of course you're not going to believe in miracles. And by the way, why don't you believe in God? So he wants you to identify and examine previously unexamined assumptions. Now, once that's cleared away, you realize, maybe these are possible. Maybe miracles are possible. He goes from the possible to the plausible. He argues, for example, in Miracles, that it's not unlikely that an omnipotent, omniscient being could do such things if he so cared to do them. Once you allow God in the back door, well, he's not going to sit around and do nothing, you know. There might be a miracle or two. He then goes from the plausible to the pleasurable. And here's where his writing ability comes into play, of course. What is plausible then becomes quite beautiful, because Lewis can conjure up these images so evocatively. And then he goes from the pleasurable to the promising. And that's the key step in Lewis. This is what's waiting for us. So you went with skepticism, then something to what could be, it's possible, finally to wanting this thing to happen. And you really don't know quite how he pulled it off. And one of the ways he pulls it off is small steps along the way. And what does that promise lead to? Well, it leads to blazing desire. Blazing desire, which is the heart of joy. It's this longing that we have. I wonder if there are many readers of Traherne in the room, the poet Traherne. Lewis was a reader of Traherne. Thomas Traherne in the 17th century has a wonderful poem called Desire, which Lewis would have known. Here's Thomas Traherne on desire, which is the end point of the four P's that Lewis employs. For giving me desire, an eager thirst, a burning ardent fire, a virgin infant flame, a love with which into the world I came, an inward hidden heavenly love, which my soul did work and move and ever me inflame with restless longing, heavenly avarice that never could be satisfied, that did incessantly a paradise unknown suggest, and something undescribed discern, and bear me to it. Be thy name forever praised by me. Now, we know that Lewis talked about desire in terms of thirst and hunger. If you thirst in the world, there must be something called water to slake that thirst, although it may not be in the world. Well, Lewis was not the first to say this. And in my judgment, I like Lewis as a poet. I don't think he's a major poet. This is more evocative and beautiful, I think, than anything Lewis ever wrote in verse, because it says best, I think, what is at the heart of Lewis. He called it joy, or the German word Sehnsucht, but it's nothing other than desire. So Thomas Traherne has really said it better, I think, than anyone else could have said it. However, to be perfectly fair, Lewis was also a very rational person. Last night in my talk, I made reference to the quite wonderful and quite nasty Deborah Winger. Those of you who were here last night know my reference. I don't want to pick on Debs too much, especially because I'm about to quote her. Because at that round table, she said one of the most incisive things about C.S. Lewis that I've ever heard, as good as any piece of literary criticism, summing up Lewis, as I've ever read. Somebody asked Deborah Winger if she thought, for those of you who aren't aware, Deborah Winger played Joy Davidman in the movie Shadowlands, and that's why I invoke her name. Doesn't C.S. Lewis give simple answers, and really they meant simplistic answers, to complicated questions? Obviously meaning to dig at Lewis. And she said, no. He may make difficult questions accessible. I don't think he makes the answers easy at all. I don't think he really answers questions. I think he discusses them. He's in that school of discourse where his statements are not like books that are written by experts. He's saying, think about this. That's why I think he opened Christianity to so many people. He wasn't dogmatic. An interesting answer. This morning I had the pleasure of meeting with one of the professors at the college who asked me, she says, over here, I think, asked me if what I thought of Lewis claiming not to be a theologian, which he wasn't. He wasn't a trained systematic theologian. Well, that's the answer. Because he could look at questions from our lay point of view and discuss them and say, think of it this way. That's why Lewis seems so plausible. Well, I think that's a good answer, and I think that's all very true. But that's not the magic of C.S. Lewis. That's not the magic of joy, and that's not the magic of eidos, and it's not the magic of desire. Lewis, I for some reason, from the earliest I can remember, I loved to argue. I'll argue about absolutely anything. And I overdo it. It's something of a vice. For me, argument is recreational, and people around me get impatient and they walk away, and, you know, that kind of thing. And it's not the only thing I do, but I just like to do it. Like William T. Kirkpatrick, the great monk. So that's an attraction in Lewis for me, because nobody argues better than C.S. Lewis. But that's not the magic he works on your soul. He works that magic on your mind. On your soul, he does the following. And here's where I'm digging into the Chronicles of Narnia, with some apologies, because I'm the invited speaker, and I get to quote the passages I love so much. But I'm sure that everybody in this room can pick any other 10 or 15 or 20 passages and do the very same thing. So enjoy with me Dr. Jobson's admonition that I mentioned last night. People need to be reminded more often than instructed. So I hope this reminds you of some passages. There's one point when we hear they say Aslan is on the moon, perhaps has already landed. And now a very curious thing happened. None of the children knew who Aslan was, any more than you do. But the moment the beaver had spoken these words, everyone felt quite different. At the name of Aslan, each one of the children felt something jump in its inside. Edmund felt a sensation of mysterious horror. Peter felt suddenly brave and adventurous. Susan felt as if some delicious smell or some delightful strain of music had just floated by. And Lucy got the feeling you have when you wake up in the morning and realize that it is the beginning of the holidays or the beginning of summer. Now, that's the kind of evocative imagery that Lewis is capable of. And it's the kind of thing, I think, well, I said this is personal, so I'm speaking for myself. You get it immediately. You just nod right away. In a different book, this is about Shasta, the horse and the boy. Once more, he felt the warm breath of the thing on his hand and face. There, he said, that is not the breath of a ghost. Tell me your sorrows. Now, we learn, of course, that this is Aslan. Shasta has no idea who this is. And they have a little talk, and the voice says, I do not call you unfortunate. Well, don't you think it was bad luck to meet so many lions, said Shasta. There was only one lion. What on earth do you mean? I just told you. Is it? Yeah. Okay. What on earth do you mean? I've just told you there were at least two the first night, and there was only one. But he was swift of foot. How do you know? I was the lion. Who are you? Asked Shasta. And if you want the theological explanation of the Trinity, you'd have some heavy thinking to do. I know that when skeptical friends and atheist friends ask me to explain that doctrine, I get wobbly in my knees. But if you want an imaginative explanation, myself, said the voice, very deep and low, so that the earth shook. And again, myself, loud and clear and gay, and then a third time, myself, whispered so softly you could hardly hear it. But still, one line. You all have some favorite passages of your own, and perhaps your favorite passage is favorite because it has some tangential personal meaning to you. It so happens that, as with C.S. Lewis, my mother died when I was young. I was 8 years old. And so, when you get to the magician's nephew, he's brought back the apple. He could have robbed it, but he didn't. Instead, Aslan gave him a slice. He peeled it and cut it up and gave it to her, piece by piece. And no sooner had she finished it than she smiled and her head sank back on the pillow and she was asleep. A real, natural, gentle sleep without any of those nasty drugs, which was, as Diggory knew, the thing in the whole world that she wanted most, the sleep that is. And he was sure now that her face looked a little different. He bent down and kissed her very softly, stole out of the room with a beating heart. About a week after this, he was quite certain that Diggory's mother was getting better. Out of context, this is a moving passage. In context, when you realize that the boy could have stolen the apple and is told by Aslan it would still be a magic apple. And yes, it still would have cured his mother, but consequences down the road would have made him wish that he hadn't fed it to his mother. you realize what the morality of the tale really treats of. Doing the right thing when everything else tells you to do the wrong thing. Here's a passage on the creation of Narnia. And one of the things about this passage that I like so much is that Frank the Cabby is present for it. Frank the Cabby, of course, is every man. There were no words. There was hardly even a tune. But it was, beyond comparison, the most beautiful noise he had ever heard. It was so beautiful, he could hardly bear it. One moment, there had been nothing but darkness. Next moment, a thousand points of light leaped out. Single stars, constellations, and planets, brighter and bigger than any in our world. If you had seen and heard it, as Diggory did, you would have felt quite certain that it was the stars themselves which were singing. Frank thought that if he had heard this earlier, he would have been a much better man. Well, we could go on quoting a lot of Narnia, I think, but I won't. Instead, I want to quote a review of Narnia. Now, you may be expecting one of the many good reviews of Narnia, but I'm going to quote a negative review of Narnia. You remember at the end of the last battle, when there are the dwarves inside the hut, and they simply can't see what's around them because they just choose not to believe? It was Madeleine L'Engle who once said, yes, seeing is believing, but sometimes believing is seeing, and they just won't believe, so they can't see anything. Here is a review of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe from someone on Amazon.com. I bought these books to have something nice to read to my grandkids. I had to stop, however, because the books are nothing more than an advertisement for Turkish Delight. A candy in the UK. The whole point of buying books for my grandkids was to give them a break from advertising. And here throughout our ads for this Turkish Delight. How much money is this Mr. Lewis getting from Cadbury's chocolate company anyway? This man must be laughing all the way to the bank. Talk about dwarves who can't see. I mean, that's just wonderful. You know. Anyway, this vision of joy, of course, is all over us. And it's not just in the places you would expect. Here is a short passage from The Problem of Pain. Now, I don't know how many of you have read The Problem of Pain. It's not an easy book, and I don't think it was an easy book for Lewis to write. I mean, it's a tough question to take on. Finally, he gives pain as God's megaphone to the world, that kind of thing. But then he goes on to say at the end the following, and by the way, pay special attention always to Lewis's conclusions, because that's when he pulls out all the stops, even in Miracles, which is very ratiocinate. At the end, he pulls out all the stops. All the things that you have ever deeply possessed, I'm sorry, all the things that have ever deeply possessed your soul have been but hints of it, tantalizing glimpses, promises never quite fulfilled, echoes that died away just as they caught your ear. But if it should really become manifest, if there ever came an echo that did not die away, but swelled into the sound itself, you would know it. Beyond all possibility of doubt, you would say, here at last is the thing I was made for. In The Weight of Glory, we read the following. The sense that in this universe we are treated as strangers, the longing to be acknowledged, to meet with some response, to bridge some chasm that yawns between us and reality, is part of our inconsolable secret. Now that's as good a definition of joy as you'll find, and it comes in that sermon that I've mentioned earlier as being so important, The Weight of Glory. Apparently then, our lifelong nostalgia, our longing to be reunited with something in the universe from which we now feel cut off, to be on the inside of some door which we have only seen from the outside, is no mere neurotic fancy, but the truest index of our real situation. This is how cut off we are from our culture in some ways, because to give voice to this longing is to seem neurotic to the world, because in the culture there is no other world but this. But you know better, because this longing will be satisfied never in this world, but only in the other. Well, of course, Lucy knew that, didn't she? We cannot mingle with the pleasures we see, but all the leaves of the New Testament are rustling with the rumor that it will not always be so. Someday, God willing, we shall get in. As I said earlier, many people have understood this and have voiced it. St. Augustine famously at the beginning of the Confessions says this. So did Thomas Aquinas. Man's last end is the term of his normal appetite, so that when he has obtained it, he desires nothing more. Natural desire cannot be empty, since nature does nothing in vain. Therefore, man's natural desire can be fulfilled, but not in this life, as we have shown. Therefore, it must be fulfilled after this life. Therefore, man's ultimate happiness is after this life. And then there's this from an unlikely source. I think most human beings have the grace of desire once in their lives, at least. And of course it is God giving each man and woman, according to their capacity, a glimpse of his promise to them, an impression of what eternity could mean, a glimpse of their adoption as sons of God. We are all left with a feeling of exhilaration, and yet at the same time, hand in hand with its happiness, a sadness that we are unlikely to encounter it again in this life. You may recall in Surprised by Joy, when Lewis converted, he no longer paid any attention to the feeling of longing or sense. He understood that it was a message, he understood what the message was about. Now his business was to get, you know, to the origin of the message. The message didn't matter anymore at that point. That, by the way, was from My Name Escapes Me, the autobiography of Alec Guinness, Sir Alec Guinness, the actor. He wrote that after he converted to Catholicism, and after his conversion, he wrote that, became quite a devoted Christian. Now, a couple of things. I'm coming to a conclusion. Isn't that? I think of some of the weak sermons I've heard, and I have to tell you the truth, as a practicing church-going Catholic, almost all I hear are weak sermons. I don't know why this is the case. Well, I'm sorry, Father Nicholas. I think Catholic preachers are just the worst. And the words I fear most in the sermon on Sunday is, in conclusion, because I know that there's another just boring 6, 7, or 8 minutes. There's no conclusion at all. No, in conclusion means I'm just making a transition to something else. So I'm telling you, I'm drawing to a conclusion now with a few thoughts. Most people in this room, I think, have read Mere Christianity. Chapter 10 of Book 1 is about hope. Now, given what I said about desire, you would think that this chapter would be the strongest, or strong. In fact, in my judgment, it's very short, and it's one of the weakest things C.S. Lewis ever wrote. It's very perfunctory. He does say some very good things. He said it was medieval thinkers and evangelicals who helped end slavery, because they're the ones who kept their eye on heaven. You see, it's the belief in heaven that makes things work best on earth. He said, our culture is breaking apart because we have forgotten that there's heaven. We don't believe in heaven anymore. That's why things are going so badly. And then he talks about the imagery of heaven, and he says, you know, when people say silly things like the imagery in the New Testament doesn't matter, we're supposed to be like doves, what does that mean? And Lewis says, well, it doesn't mean you're supposed to lay eggs. And then he stops. He stops short. And that surprised me and kind of disappointed me. Instead, he has some poetry, and I don't know how many of you are readers of Lewis's poetry, but I would, almost in conclusion, like to read some of Lewis's poetry. Now, to give you an idea of what Lewis doesn't mean, it's often useful to know what a person is responding against. And in this case, it would be despair. He has a poem called Legion. I wonder if any of you know this particular poem. Lord, hear my voice, my present voice I mean, not that which may be speaking an hour hence, for I am legion in an opposite sense, and not by show of hands decide between the multiple factions which my state has seen or will see. Condescend to the presence that what speaks now, I'm sorry, to the pretense that what speaks now is the real I. In its defense, dissolve my parliament and intervene. Thou wilt not, though we asked it, quite recall free will once given. Yet to this moment's choice, give unfair weight. Hold me to this, O strain of point. Use legal fictions, for if all my quarreling selves must bear an equal voice, farewell. Thou hast created me in vain. Well, that's pretty strong stuff. And it's coming from C.S. Lewis. There is another, a bit more amusing poem, but it expresses despair in the same way, except narratively. I'm sure many of you know this wonderful poem called The Late Passenger. How many of you do know the poem, The Late Passenger? Oh, good. Only three people. Good for it. Wonderful. The sky was low, the sounding rain was falling, dense and dark, and Noah's sons were standing at the window of the ark. The beasts were in, but Japhet said, I see one creature more, belated and unmated, yeah, but knocking at the door. Well, let him knock, said Ham, or let him drown or learn to swim. We're overcrowded as it is, we've got no room for him. Yet it knocks. How terribly it knocks, said Shem. Its feet are hard as horn, but oh, the air that comes from it is sweet. Now hush, said Ham. You'll waken Dad, and once he comes to see what's at the door, it's sure to mean more work for you and me. Noah's voice came roaring from the darkness down below. Some animal is knocking. Take it in before we go. Ham shouted back. And savagely he nudged the other two. That's only Japhet knocking down a rat nail in his shoe, said Noah. Boys, I hear a noise that's like a horse's hoof, said Ham. Why, that's the dreadful rain that drops upon the roof. Noah tumbled up on deck, and out he put his head. His face went gray, his knees were loosed. He tore his beard and said, look, look! It would not wait. It turns away. It takes its flight. Fine work you've made of it, my sons, between you all tonight. Oh, noble and unmated beast, my sons were all unkind. In such a night, what stable and what manger will you find? Oh, long shall be the furrows plowed across the hearts of men before it comes to stable and to manger once again. And dark and crooked all the ways in which our race shall walk, and shriveled all their manhood like a flower with broken stalk. And all the world, O Ham, may curse the hour when you were born. Because of you, the ark must sail without the unicorn. There's only so much of that you can take. After reading that, you go back to Narnia for a spell. But I won't do that. Instead, I'll read a final poem from Lewis, which expresses his feeling about the quotidian effect of longing on a person. And this is a poem called The Day with a White Mark. How many of you know this poem, The Day with a White Mark? Oh, as we say in Italian, infamia. No one knows the poem The Day with the White Mark. Well, for homework, you'll have to memorize it. There will be a quiz. This is The Day with the White Mark. All day, I have been tossed and whirled in a preposterous happiness. Was it an elf in the blood, or a bird in the brain, or even part of the cloudily crested, 50-league-long, loud, uplifted wave of a journeying angel's transit, roaring over and through my heart. My garden spoiled, my holidays are canceled, the omens harden, the planned and unplanned miseries deepen, the knots draw tight. Reason kept telling me all day my mood was out of season. It was, too. In the dark ahead, the breakers are only white. Yet I could have kissed the very scullery taps. The color of my day was like a peacock's chest. In at each sense, there stole ripplings and dewy sprinkles of delight that with them drew fine threads of memory through the vibrant thickness of my soul. As though there were transparent earths and luminous trees should grow there, and shining roots worked visibly far down below one's feet. So everything, the tick of the clock, the cock crowing in the yard probing my soil, woke diverse buried hearts of mine to beat. Who knows if it will ever come again, now the day closes. No one can give me or take away that key. All depends on the elf, the bird, or the angel. I doubt if the angel himself is free to choose when sudden heaven in man begins or ends. Well, sometimes I've been asked what scripture best describes C.S. Lewis. And I mentioned the word before, which is what desire and longing and joy and things, I think, are all about. It is Lewis's greatest achievement. I hope I don't mean just in me. I really do think it's his greatest achievement. And that is the inspiration of hope, more than anything else. You read Narnia, it's there, you can make it. You read The Weight of Glory, this means something. And his imagery, as in this poem, with the white mark, tells us so. There are three verses that I think are best to summarize Lewis. Of course, Hebrews is old and reliable, Hebrews 6, 19 to 20. I will shower blessings upon you. We now have found safety, encouragement to take a firm grip on the hope that is held out to us. Here we have an anchor for our soul, as sure that it's and reaching right through beyond the veil where Jesus entered before us and on our behalf. And second, there's Romans 5:5. Those sufferings bring patience. Patience brings perseverance. And perseverance brings hope. And this hope is not deceptive, because the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, that oil of gladness, which has been given to us, and which, in my judgment, Lewis gives us better than anything else except the New Testament itself. Finally, the verse that I would suggest epitomizes C.S. Lewis is also Romans 15, 13. It's all over, Lewis. It's all over, Lewis. May the God of hope bring you such joy and peace in your faith that the power of the Holy Spirit will remove all bounds to hope. Well, that's what C.S. Lewis does for me. That's why this is so personal. And if that young man were here, I don't know, some other young man may be here, and ask, what does Lewis have to offer young people of my generation? That's my answer. And if he doesn't get it, well, let him write a review on Amazon.com and get it wrong. Thank you all very much for indulging me.